Good morning. It's a blessing to stand before you this morning. Bob tells me, excuse me, Bob tells me that we have guests that have never been here before. So a very special welcome to you. And I know that you'll be blessed and you'll be pasteurized. Before I read the announcements from the bulletin, are there any from the congregation?
We have a guest for our apple water making due to the weather, but we're going to do it October 29th.
Okay. Okay, October 29th and early, right?
Yes.
Okay. Anyone else? Anything else?
Yes, I have one about the Christmas in the Woods or Shaker Woodsville. I won't be here next weekend because I'll be in Virginia. We're there. And it's also the following weekend. We still can use some workers and we can still use donations of pop and water. It would be Diet Pepsi and Pepsi.
Sounds good. Anyone else? Yes, Pastor.
Yeah, I just want to let you all know that on the back welcome desk, there are flyers for foster care training classes that are coming up in like a couple of weeks in Steubenville. So if you or anybody you know would be interested in being a foster parent, there are trainings coming up. I know the need is pretty great. So check out those flyers if you're interested.
Anyone else? Okay, we'll go into our announcements. It says, please note there's no small group meeting tomorrow. And we are in need of desserts for Baptism Sunday, and that's October 23rd. We will be having a dessert reception after the service, so we need dessert to have dessert reception, right? Well, that'll be good. And of course, today is Sunday and worship service at 10. Tomorrow, there's no small group meeting. Wednesday, the men will be having their meeting at 6 o'clock. And the 7th on Friday is food pickup. And then Saturday is Christmas in the Woods for Four Seasons. And then we're back to Sunday, October 9th, with one Sunday to the next is like a dream. So we'll stand and join me in a call to worship and the hymn and the prayer of invocation. Remember us, O God. Breathe your spirit within us, O God.
Fill us with your power.
Shine your face upon us, O God.
Make us a people of increasing joy and unshakable hope.
Now let's join in, Great is Thy Faithfulness, 1, 2, and 3.
Thank you.
join me in our prayer of invocation. God, all I have is yours. Do with it what you will. Give me only your love and grace. That is enough for me. Amen.
I've got a quick announcement. I didn't tell you about this, Francis.
Okay, you're
so
loud.
Sorry to interrupt. You're being pasteurized. That's what you said.
Okay.
Right? For this next song, I'm going to invite Teresa Bratt and Marcia up forward. I don't know if Carol Dillon is here. If you are, you can come up too if you want. But a couple of weeks ago, they had sung There Is a Redeemer for Us. And so how this is going to go, the lyrics are going to be up there on the screen. We're going to listen to Linda play and those two sing the first verse. But then we're going to join in with them as a congregation, and we're going to re-sing verses one, and then we're going to move forward. So we're listening, but then we're going to join in for verse one again, and then we're going to go from there. Sound good? All right. Come on up, Marcia and Teresa. Nothing like Pastor Ryan asking you forward to lead us, and I don't check to make sure the lyrics are the same as the lyrics here. God bless you two. I love you, and thank you. Thank you for your sacrifice this morning. We sure do appreciate it. All right, you all may be seated. Kids, come forward. We're going to do the children's moment. Hey, good morning, you all. How are you doing? Doing all right? I see some of you got some warm weather gear on. It's getting cold out there, isn't it? Do you all like this colder weather? Anybody? Nobody? Just a little bit. Mostly you just like the warmer weather, huh? I get it. Well, today we are going to be taking... Do you like the colder weather, Elsie? Yeah? You know what's getting closer and closer and closer? Snow. Snowman. You like it? And that makes me feel so good that you're looking forward to that. Yeah. Yeah, when it gets cold out, it's a little bit harder to play outside. Well, today is a special day. Because look behind you real quick. Do you see what's up on the altar? We're going to be taking communion. Now, when we take communion, we have bread. What else do we have up there? Mm-hmm. Wine, juice, yep. Uh-huh. We have bread and juice. And what does the bread and juice or wine, what does it represent for us? Who can tell me? Alexander, what do you got? Yeah. Yeah, Jesus, you're right on track. Jesus' blood and body. So when we take communion, we remember how Jesus gave of his body and he shed his blood for us on the cross. You know what's really, really, really cool about today? Today is World Communion Sunday. Have you ever heard of that before? What that means is that right now, and maybe a little bit earlier, and maybe a little bit later today, people from all over the world are also going to be taking communion. That all people who are believers, most churches take communion today. Now, do you think that we are exactly the same as those believers who are going to take communion in China? Do you think we're exactly the same? No. We're not exactly the same. They speak a different language. Maybe they live in locations that look a little bit different than where we live out here. Maybe they look a little bit different. Maybe they dress a little bit different. Do you think we're exactly the same as the believers in Africa who are going to be taking communion today? No. Again, they may look a little different. They may speak a little different. They may meet together in a place that looks a little bit different than our church. But check this out. I think this is so, so cool. Even though we're different, we're all united and brought together when we take communion on the same day. We're reminded that even though we might not look the same or talk the same or live in the same place, that we are brought together by Jesus and what he did for us on the cross. This got me thinking. Now, you can tell me if this is a good thought or just like, let it be, Pastor Ryan. But I was thinking of a rainbow when I thought of World Communion Sunday. Because think of a rainbow. You know what makes it so special? All the different colors, right? You have orange and yellow and green and violet, but they all come together to make a rainbow. What if a rainbow was just all orange? Would it be as cool? Oh, no. It wouldn't be. Our rainbow is so cool because we have different colors that are different, but they come together and paint a beautiful picture. That's why we love rainbows so much. So we're going to pray now. We're going to ask for God to bless all of the believers around the world and that he would unite us with them. Let's pray. Jesus, I'm so grateful that when we believe in you, we don't have to be like everybody else. We get to continue to be who you made us to be and unique and different. But Lord, I'm also so grateful that even though we're all different, that we're also united by the cross. Lord, we pray for all of our brothers and sisters around the world, fellow believers in Jesus who will be celebrating communion today. And Lord, we pray that you would unite us to them in a miraculous way. We ask this all in your name. Amen. Amen. Well, you all can get your suckers and then head back to your class. As the kids are making their way and as the ushers prepare to come forward to give out the offering plates, I do want to give you a quick update here. And this is something that I am celebrating and I want for us to celebrate together as a faith family. Throughout September, we had been collecting money for oncology research at Children's of Pittsburgh. And we collected throughout September $923. So I want to give you a round of applause there. And then check this out. Betty made the hot mustard, and the proceeds from those sales were also going to be added in to that total to be sent to the hospital. So we're probably closer to like a grand with what Betty had made. So we're so grateful for you, Betty, and for doing that as well. Again, this is just a reminder of how we, as the people here at Bell Chapel, we can put some money together, we can be united on a mission in this small way, but how it can have a big impact. Think of the kids that and families that will be blessed through the money that we are giving to that research. I'm really excited about that. This month, for the first three Sundays of October, our Mission Can giving is going to go to our church's scholarship fund. So each year we give out scholarship money as funds are available to worthy applicants connected to the life of our church here. So this is another worthy cause for you, and I ask that you would consider giving to it. We'll also have our typical plates going around for the general fund as well. Ushers, please come up, and we'll get these things getting passed around here. For the doxology. Heavenly Father, we're aware that each and every one of us will give our allegiance to something. Each and every one of us here this morning will believe in something. Lord, we gather together this morning to say that we give our trust to you, that we align with you, that we believe in you and you alone. So Holy Spirit, I pray that you would be at work here, that you would minister to each of us, that you would move in this place so that we would forfeit everything else in the world, but that we would be all in worship to King Jesus. Spirit, we also ask that you would anoint this morning's offering and that you would work through it to advance the kingdom of God. We pray this all in your name, Jesus. Amen. You all may be seated. As we continue on in the service, we are going to have our time of prayer where we get to gather together as brothers and sisters and we get to approach our Heavenly Father's throne room and get an audience with the King himself. We're going to be praying for Mary Ellen Grafton, her continued recovery. We're going to be continuing to lift up Mark, Teresa Bratt's brother, as he's showing some signs of improvement, but there's still just a long, long way to go for him. We're going to be praying for Francis Furby's sister, Margaret, and her brother-in-law, Bob. They've been affected by Hurricane Ian. They live down there in Sarasota. And at the time I talked to Francis this past week, I think they were in a shelter of some sorts.
They're home now.
Okay. So we'll be thanking God for just how he's seen them through, but we'll be keeping all those, you know, in our prayers who maybe do have quite a bit of damage or even those who've lost their lives because of that hurricane down there. We're also going to be praying for Mark Clark's wife, Lee. It sounds like she's had bronchitis for quite a bit of time and just can't quite get rid of it fully. So we're going to be lifting her up. A few others here. Carol Smith's son, David, who we had been praying for, who had just some health issues he was working through with his foot. Carol told me this morning that David is continuing to just do really well. And so we're going to thank God for how he's answered prayers, and we're going to be praying that he continues to bless David. And lastly on my list here is we're going to be lifting up Tim Albin. This is a man who was in a bad motorcycle wreck, and he has, it sounds like, some brain damage, and his wife is back at home in the process of recovery, but Tim's really still in the thick of things. So those are the things that I'll be lifting up, but we're going to come together and we're going to lift all of our prayers to God. We're going to begin this time of prayer with our prayer hymn, which is Trust and Obey, and we're just going to sing verse 1. as your children, we have been given some promises from you. And one of the great promises we have is that when we cry out to you in prayer, that you hear us 100% of the time. That when we cry out to you with our joys and our concerns, that not only do you hear, but you empathize with us. Perhaps best of all, Father, you give us the promise that each and every time we pray, something happens. So, Lord, during this time, I do ask that you would hear the cries of your children. Lord, we are thanking you for being active in the world today. We're so grateful that you're a God that draws near and acts on our behalf. You don't just keep us at arm's distance, or you don't look at us apathetically without care, but you do something and you help us, Lord. And we're so grateful for how you have been with David and how you've seen him through a major procedure and how you've helped him to begin the process of healing. And Lord, we pray that healing would just continue to come. Lord, we are so grateful for how you saw both Margaret and Bob through the hurricane down there in Florida. And we're grateful to you for that. Lord, we do ask that you would be with all those who were affected by Hurricane Ian and all those who are beginning the process of putting the pieces back together. Lord, we pray that through this situation that many would come to know your love and your mercy through your Son, Jesus Christ. Lord, be with Mary Ellen. Help her to continue to get stronger. Help her to know that she is loved by you and by so many others. Continue to be at work in the life of Mark. Lord, as he's still in the midst of health concerns and struggles, and perhaps even as decisions need to be made on his behalf by the family, Lord, just bring your peace, your healing, and your guidance. Lord, be with Lee as she has bronchitis and she just can't seem to kick it. Lord, help to give her your healing so that she can be healthy moving forward. Lord, we also think of Tim, who has brain damage and who's, you know, still just really in a bad place, broken physically. Lord, be with his family as they're no doubt worried and anxious and uncertain. Reach out to their hearts, Lord. Lord, we know that you can do the unthinkable, that you are the great physician. So, Lord, even now as Tim is facing so many concerns and issues, we pray that you would touch him in a mysterious way, and that even now, healing would begin to happen, and that it would be a testament to the God who can move mountains. Jesus, as your disciples today, we join all your disciples throughout the ages in praying the prayer you taught to us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Friends, we know that Jesus was a person who prayed. We know that, right? Shake your heads, yes, make me feel good. We know that. Yeah, we've been talking about that. Jesus devoted himself to prayer. Jesus made prayer a priority. There were some things in his life that, you know, maybe he'd get to when he got to. He was busy after all. But prayer was one of those things that was non-negotiable for Jesus. He made sure that he prayed. As we read scripture, it seems like Jesus was in this constant communication with his heavenly Father. And so it doesn't seem like prayer was so much something that Jesus did as much as it was a part of who Jesus was. Prayer was like at the core of his being. And because prayer was at the core of who he was as a person, we see Jesus praying during the good times and during the bad times as well. I want to rest here just a moment. Think about that. Jesus prayed constantly, whether things were going really, really well or really, really bad. I think, if you're like me, that we oftentimes are more likely to pray during a certain situation in life than we would be in another situation. For instance, many of us here maybe find prayer more organic or more easy when we're going through a really tough time when it seems like things are falling apart. But we may have a harder time going to God in prayer when it seems like things are kind of just, well, not too shabby. You know what I mean? Many of us here may run to the Lord in prayer and find it easy to pray when we're facing big decisions. But it can be so easy for us to forget that we need to pray when it seems like, you know what? We know what to do. We got it figured out. No doubt, we find ourselves praying just naturally when we're confronted with our lack of control in our lives and in the world. But when we feel like we've got a handle on things, like we're in control and we've got our future steps planned out, it is so easy for us to forget that we need to communicate with God. But do you see how this wasn't the case for Jesus? For Jesus, each and every moment of life was an opportunity to hear from God, to be heard by God, to seek the Father's will, and to humble himself before it. We know from this sermon series, Pray Like Jesus, that Jesus prayed during life's big moments, during in the midst of the hoopla, when he could have been preoccupied with 1,000 other things, Jesus ran to his Father in prayer. We know that Jesus prayed during life's busyness. Jesus had 3 years to implement and begin a revolution that would change the world forever. You think he was busy? Of course he was. And yet in the midst of the busyness, with the weight of expectations and stress and anxiety, he ran to the Father in prayer. Last week we saw that Jesus went to the Father in prayer during seasons of change. And we looked at how in the midst of that season of change, how Jesus' prayers, his like prayer circle, the things he was praying for, how it began kind of small, but it got bigger and bigger and bigger. He was getting ready to leave the disciples. He was preparing them for his departure. He knew the cross was drawing near. And in his last moments of kind of peace and comfort with the disciples, he prayed to God and he asked God for strength, that he would stay true to the mission God had given him, that he'd remain true to the calling. Jesus knew the last of his life was coming up and he wanted to be faithful to the end. Jesus went on and he began to pray for his disciples, and you could hear the sadness in his prayer, like, Father, I've been with these people and I love these people and I'm getting ready to leave them. And he asked God to take care of them in his absence. Father, provide for them. Look after them. I'm not going to be around to do it anymore. Lastly, Jesus prayed for all those who would come to believe in his name. All believers throughout the ages. I told you, Jesus said a prayer for you and I on that day with his disciples. And he did. He said a prayer for all of us. Remember what he prayed for in particular for all his followers? And I kind of emphasize this. Unity amongst believers. There's more to that that can be said. We're not going to dwell there. But out of all the things Jesus could pray for all those who would come to saving faith in him, he said, Father, help them be united as one, just like me and you are one together. Pretty interesting. This morning, we're going to look at another prayer of Jesus. And when you think of Jesus praying, there's a really, really good chance that this is the scripture you think of. We started with Jesus praying at his baptism in week one, and slowly but surely, we've been working our way to Jesus' prayers towards the end of his life. Here we find Jesus praying in a truly heart-wrenching way. Let's read it together now. The scripture will be up there on the screen. We're going to be reading Mark chapter 14, verses 32 through 42. This is what it says. They went to a place called Gethsemane, and Jesus said to his disciples, "Sit here while I pray." He took Peter, James, and John along with him, and he began to be deeply distressed and troubled. "My soul is overwhelmed with sorrow to the point of death," he said to them. "Stay here and keep watch." Going a little farther, he fell to the ground and prayed that if possible, the hour might pass from him. "Abba, Father," he said, "everything is possible for you. Take this cup from me, yet not what I will, but what you will." Then he returned to his disciples and found them sleeping. "Simon," he said to Peter, "are you asleep? Couldn't you keep watch for 1 hour? Watch and pray so that you will not fall into temptation. The spirit is willing, but the flesh is weak." Once more he went away and prayed the same thing. When he came back, he again found them sleeping because their eyes were heavy. They did not know what to say to him. Returning the third time, he said to them, "Are you still sleeping and resting? Enough! The hour has come. Look, the Son of Man is delivered into the hands of sinners. Rise, let us go. Here comes my betrayer." Here in this scripture, we find that Jesus was with the 11 disciples, and that should kind of catch our curiosity because we know there were how many disciples? 12, right? So this has happened after Judas is kind of now out of the fold. They've already had that meal where Jesus kind of tells them, "Hey, I know you're going to betray me. Like, go and do that work which you're going to do." So now the 12 disciples have been whittled down to 11. And we read that Jesus goes with the 11 to a garden called Gethsemane, located on the Mount of Olives, which was just outside the city of Jerusalem. And you might have heard it. They go to the garden there on the Mount of Olives to pray, the scripture tells us. Now, after entering the garden with the 11, Jesus looks at 8 of them and says, "Hey, you 8 just kind of chill here, stay here." And then he takes 3, Peter, James, and John, with him deeper into the garden. We read that as Jesus takes the 3 a little bit deeper and away from the other disciples, that Jesus began to be deeply distressed and troubled. You hear the weight of that? Jesus began to be deeply distressed and troubled. Then listen to Jesus' words that he speaks to Peter, James, and John. "My soul is overwhelmed with sorrow to the point of death." To the point of death. Jesus is saying that he's so distressed, that he's so troubled, that literally he felt like he was going to die right there in that moment. He was so overwhelmed by what he was experiencing and feeling spiritually, mentally, emotionally, that he thought he was going to die. He was questioning whether or not he would even live to see another hour or two. Do you feel the weight of what Jesus must have been feeling to be so downtrodden that you felt that he felt like he was literally going to die? Luke in his gospel goes a little bit further And listen to how Luke portrays the same exact moment, because Luke really gets to the depth, I think, of Jesus' despair. Luke tells us in his gospel that Jesus was in anguish. The Greek word used for anguish here is agonia. What's that sound like in our English language? Agony. Jesus was in agonia. The definition for that Greek word is this: intense, violent sorrow, anxiety. This was a sorrow and an anxiety that was like violent in nature. It didn't just come on easy, and it wasn't something that, like, Jesus was in hand-to-hand combat with anxiety, and sorrow was threatening to swallow him up. You know what's really, really, really interesting about this Greek word? When we find it here in Luke to describe Jesus' agony, that's the only time it's in Scripture altogether, that one single time. Now, I don't know why the writer of Luke used this unique word and why it was never used anywhere else in the Bible, but I wonder if he wanted us to know that what Jesus was experiencing, the depths of his sorrow and anxiety, were so great that nobody else before him had ever experienced it, or nobody else after him would ever experience it again. It's almost like the writer was saying, I'm going to use this one word, this unique word, because I want my readers to know that what Jesus was facing in that moment was unlike anything else any human being, anybody else would ever experience. And Luke further describes the anguish. We read that Jesus was having such a tough time that an angel from heaven appeared to him and strengthened him. Jesus was so close to being consumed by his grief that God sent an angel from heaven to minister to him. And notice that the angel appeared to strengthen him, not comfort him. The angel didn't show up to take away Jesus' pain or to make him help him escape from this moment of grief. The angel showed up to provide Jesus with just enough strength so as to not be swallowed up by it. Angel showed up to help hold Jesus up as he continued his suffering. We'd said that Jesus was at a place called Gethsemane, a garden located on the Mount of Olives. Gethsemane in Greek means oil press. Did any of you ever hear that before? This was a place where there would have been a big, maybe a community oil press. So they would take olives from the surrounding Mount of Olives, where there would have been olive trees growing everywhere, and they would bring the olives to Gethsemane, the place of the oil press, and that is where these olives would be pressed down for the precious olive oil. Gethsemane, do you see what's going on here? Gethsemane is the place where olives are brought to be crushed. Gethsemane is the place where olives are brought to be mangled and put under such great pressure and stress that literally they burst open and their fluids come out. Here, at the place of the oil press, Gethsemane, we find Jesus, and he's emotionally and mentally being crushed and broken to the point that he too begins to burst. His inner fluids begin to come out. Luke tells us that his sweat was like blood. Do you see how his inner fluids are coming out because of the pressure and stress he was under? Jesus prays. As he's being crushed, as he's questioning whether or not he's going to make it through this moment, we find that Jesus goes to the Father, like he's done so many times before, and he prays. He tells the three, stay here, and then he goes on a little bit further into the garden, and now he's just by himself. The eight are far away, the three are far away, and it's just him. And the Scripture tells us that Jesus fell to the ground and began to pray. I was curious about fall, that word fall. He fell to the ground. Does this mean that Jesus, like, knelt to the ground? You know how sometimes we'll take a knee and, and pray? Does this mean that Jesus calmly, you know, put a hand down and then like sat cross-legged on the ground in the Garden of Gethsemane? This word for fall means crumble. Paul uses it to describe the walls of Jericho crumbling down on top of themselves. Later, Paul uses this to describe what happened when Jesus manifested to him and said, "Saul, Saul, why do you persecute my people?" Paul and the rest of the people with him fell to the ground because they experienced God in such a way that it brought them terror and fear. This is the same Greek word used here. So you see, Jesus doesn't like go to a knee calmly. Jesus doesn't, you know, kind of find a nice little place by an olive tree and rest his back against it to pray. Friends, Jesus falls into a heap on the ground. This falling wasn't planned. It was sudden. He collapsed. He was under so much strain that his body literally gave out from underneath of him. And he begins to pray. What does he pray? It tells us here. He prayed that if it was possible for this hour to pass from him. Specifically, here's his words. "Abba, Father, everything is possible for you. Take this cup from me, yet not what I will, but what you will." Three times, it tells us, Jesus prayed these words. "Father, I know anything is possible for you. Take this cup from me, but not what I will, what you will." The fact that he prayed this three times shows us that Jesus was literally begging and pleading that somehow, some way, he could be rescued from this moment, from the terror that he was experiencing. Let's look at the contents of Jesus' prayer really, really quickly. "Father, everything is possible for you." Jesus is pleading with God, "God, say the word, and I know you can save me from this. Father, I know that you have all the power. I was with you when we created the universe. I know anything you say can come to pass. Father, just say the word and save me. I know you're capable." Then he opens up to God and he says, "Father, I'm desiring something different. I desire this suffering to pass. My heart is to not experience the pain I'm going through right now." But then did you hear how that prayer ended? "But Father, thy will be done, not my will." Father, I know you can do it. I know you're with me. I know you hear me. Father, you know the desires of my heart. But at the end of the day, Father, do your will, not my own will. Friends, maybe like no other time in his life, Jesus was really at a crossroads, wasn't he? He was at a crossroads of faith, maybe. Here he is. He's on the ground, fighting for his life. He's curled up in a ball, and he's pleading with his Father, and he knows that God can rescue him without a shadow of a doubt. But you know what he realizes also in this moment? That even though God can rescue him, that he may not rescue him. Even though he knows that God can do something in that moment, he's also realizing that God may not do something in that moment. Isn't this a crossroads we all find ourselves at some point in time? I can guarantee you that each and every one of us here today, all who call on the name of Jesus, at some point in time will find themselves at such a crossroads of the faith where we are undergoing pain or suffering or agony. And we turn to the Father and we plead to him for help, for better health, for mending of relationship, for power over addiction. And we cry out, "Lord, we know you can do it. It's our will that you save us now. Rescue us from this moment, Lord. We're dying." But some of us may hear something similar to what Jesus heard. And the answer we receive from God may be, not yet. My will is not to do that right now for whatever reason. Remember, three times Jesus pleaded, and three times the answer he got back from God was, this cup of suffering is yours to drink. Have any of you ever heard that reply from God? Have you ever poured your heart out to God and said, Lord, I need you. Do something. I'm dying here. But the answer you get back is, this is the path that I've willed for you to walk during the season. I want to take just a bit of time to reflect on what Jesus does next. Because this is a crossroads. This means faith. This is a place where faith can be abandoned, or this is a place where trust can be strengthened. We know at this crossroads that Jesus trusting God seemed to be strengthened. Because you know what happens after this? He keeps being obedient to God all the way to the point of his murder on the cross. What will we do when we're in these crossroads? Because you know what? It's so easy to do when you're praying to God and the answer is, for this season, this is what is my will for whatever reason. You know what we can do? We can say, the heck with this. If this is what I get for putting my faith in God, I'll go it alone. Because it's not working. I thought faith was supposed to help me. Well, this doesn't seem to be helping me. We can fall away. You know what we can think when we're at a crossroads and it feels like God's not answering us, or at least he's not doing something in that moment, even though our suffering continues? It can be really easy for us to say either God's not real, or God is real, but he just doesn't care, or God is real and he cares, but he's just not good. You see how our minds can be tempted to think that way? Or we can double down in faith like Jesus did and said, God is real. I know he hears me. I know he's with me. I know he cares about what I'm going through. And I know he's good. So even if the suffering doesn't pass, God will be all those things. You know what? I'm just going to trust that there will be redemption someday. In the back of Jesus' mind, as his trust remained strong, he had to believe that someday, some way, somehow, God would redeem it all. That his suffering in that moment, his future suffering on the cross, that someday God would rescue him, and that someday his suffering would be no more. Friends, in the midst of our suffering, when we're drinking from the cup that doesn't seem like it's getting passed away from us, we've got to know that some way, somehow, God will redeem our suffering. The redemption might not come in this season, in that moment, but may we too, like Jesus, say, I trust that in God's good time, someday, not so far from now, God's going to bring wholeness to me in this whole situation. One day, my brokenness will be made into something beautiful by the hands of the Father. I want to continue to reflect on this as we take communion. As we take communion, as we celebrate it, we are really celebrating the fact that Jesus was broken for us, that he suffered such great sorrow for us, so that someday we can know for certain that our suffering will be redeemed. So take a moment, spend time with God in prayer. I will invite the ushers. Well, we'll go through the liturgy here in a second once I have the elements together. And then a little bit later, I'll invite the 8 ushers to come forward to distribute the elements. Spend a moment in prayer. Thank you. Let's draw near to the table of our Lord. Please join me in the liturgy, which will be up on the screen. You all will be reading the bold. Christ our Lord invites to his table all who love him, who earnestly repent of their sin and seek to live in peace with one another. Therefore, let us confess our sin before God and one another. We have not believed you or trusted in your power. Lord, help our unbelief. We have stained our souls by both our action and inaction. Cleanse us, Lord. We are broken by disease, bruised by the sins of others, weakened and unable to repair ourselves. Heal us, Lord. We ignore your call to center our lives in you, and so are deaf to the hopes and cries of the poor, the sick, the needy, and the earth. Ground us, Lord. Hear these promises from the word of God, Scripture, for all that truly repent and turn to the Lord. The saying is sure and worthy of full acceptance that Christ Jesus came into the world to save sinners. If we confess our sins, God is faithful and just and will forgive our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. God so loved the world that he gave his only Son, that whoever believes in him should not perish but have eternal life. Come to me, all you who are weary and burdened, and I will give you rest. Each of you this morning who have repented and believed as we've gone through this liturgy, I want you to hear these words. I want you to let these words take deep root into your soul. God's mercy for you is infinite. When he forgives you completely. In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven. In the name of Jesus Christ, we are forgiven. Glory to God. Amen. The Lord be with you and also with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right to give our thanks. It is right and a good and joyful thing, always and everywhere, to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. And so with your people on earth and all the company of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. Join me for a prayer. Father, pour out your Holy Spirit on us gathered here and on these gifts of bread and wine. Make them be for us the body and blood of Christ, that we may be for the world the body of Christ, redeemed by his blood. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ, one with each other, and one in ministry to all the world, until Christ comes in final victory, and we feast at his heavenly banquet. Amen. Amen. At this time, I will invite the 8 ushers to come forward and to begin to distribute the elements. Thank you. On the night in which he gave himself up for us, Jesus shared a meal with the disciples. And at that meal, he took the bread and he broke the bread and he gave thanks to God the Father. And he said to the disciples, "This is my body, which is broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me." When the meal was over, Jesus took the cup and he gave thanks to God and he told the disciples, "This is my blood of the new covenant poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink of it in remembrance of me." As you're able, please stand and we're going to join in singing, "Were You There?" Verses 1, 2, and 3. Send you off with a prayer. Let's pray. Lord, in the midst of our struggles, as I see these beautiful people before me who I know are going through different things in their lives, Lord, they're experiencing hardship and pain in many different ways. Lord, protect us from the enemy. Lord, help us to know that you're with us, that you feel what we feel, and that you are, in fact, good. Lord, help us to double down in faith and trust that one day, so very soon, you will redeem everything we have gone through and will go through. Help us to be a people that trust you like your son Jesus did. Amen. You all may go in peace.